Greetings, and welcome to worship for this 20th Sunday in Ordinary Time. Well, it's great to be back. You may have noticed I was away for a few weeks on a little bit of holiday and had a great time, enjoyed the relaxation, and I hope you're getting a little bit of rest and relaxation in this summer as well. But we're welcomed back today to maybe one of the most embarrassing stories in all of the Bible. A story of Jesus behaving badly. So what do we do with that? Well, we'll reflect on that a little bit later in our sermon. But just to begin, just to say welcome to all who are joining us, however you're joining us, from far or from wide, whether you're a regular attender or viewer, or you just stumbled upon our link, it's great to have you here. Know that you are welcome, and just encourage you to check out our church community by visiting our website at gslcc.ca. Then just a couple other things. I sent out an email this week with some information from the National Office about how, well, our encouragement to pray for and to reach out and to help the appeal for Lebanon. Hopefully you got that email. But there's also an announcement in our bulletin today as well that kind of gives the same information. So I encourage you to read that over and take that up. And then just to let you know, our Pictures of Hope campaign. We've got a few more for today, but after today, we're kind of dry. I guess for the last few weeks, we haven't had a chance to encourage you to send those in. So we'll run that for a couple more weeks. If you have pictures that you want to send us, pictures that represent what hope looks like for you in these days, I'd encourage you to do that. Send them to the church office, and we'll incorporate them into our services for the next couple of weeks. Then let's take a moment to prepare our hearts and minds for worship. And then we'll begin. And we begin with our gathering hymn, which is number 853, When Morning Gilds the Skies, which is our favorite hymn request for today.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the inspiration of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God of all peoples, your arms reach out to embrace all, and your mercy seeks out those in any need. And while we gather to worship you, too often we exclude, belittle, and demean others in thought, word, and deed. Raise us to new life through the power of your grace. And teach us, as disciples of your Son, to love the world with compassion and commitment. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, we pray. Amen. And I invite the children to gather around the screen. Hi, guys. Good to see you again. It's been a while since we've been together, hasn't it? Hope you're having a good summer. We're here in the church because we haven't been here in the church for children's time for a while. So I thought it was a good time to come back to the church for today anyway. I want to show you something. Got some stuff here. You know what this is? It's a chocolate bar, right? And what do we got here? Oh, some potato chips, right? And a can of pop. You like this stuff? I love it. I love chocolate bars and chips and pop. They taste really good. But you know, there's a name we have for food like this, right? We call it junk food. We call it junk food because, well, it might taste really good, but it's not very good for you, right? And maybe your mom or your dad or your grandma or your grandpa have told you, don't eat so much junk food, or be careful, or watch how much junk food you eat, how much junk food you put into your body, right? That's good advice. We should watch that. You know, Jesus said something, though, that was surprising once. He said, what's more important than watching what you put into your body or into your mouth is watching what comes out of your mouth. Well, he was talking about our words there, because our words come out of our mouth, right? And he was saying we got to be careful, got to watch what words come out of our mouth, because our words, well, they can hurt people, right? Especially if they're bad words or bad names that we call other people, right? Maybe you've seen that. Maybe you've heard people call other people bad names, right? And maybe you can see how that can hurt people's feelings, right? We need to listen to Jesus and to watch the words that come out of our mouth so that we're not calling people bad names. You know, maybe you've been called a bad name once. You know, people do that, right? Words like stupid or dumb or something like that. And maybe that's really hurt your feelings. Maybe you know what that's like. Well, if so, I got something that I think that can help us feel better at times like that. That's kind of why I'm here at this baptism font. Because, you know, in our baptism, in your baptism, God called you a name. But God called you a good name, a really good name. God called you child of God, right? And that's about the best name anybody could ever have, right? So when somebody has called you a bad name or hurt your feelings, it's a good thing to remember your baptism. Remember the name God called you in your baptism, child of God. And I bet that'll help you feel better. But one more thing. Maybe you've actually called somebody a bad name, like your brother or your sister or somebody else, right? And maybe you've kind of felt bad about that afterwards. Well, that's another good reason to remember your baptism. Remember that name God called you. Because when you remember you're a child of God, you can remember God loves you no matter what and forgives you. And that can help you feel better when you've hurt somebody's feelings. And maybe even it can help you to not do that again, not use bad names again, right? Good to remember. How about we pray about that now, okay? Fold our hands, bow our heads, and let us pray. Thank you, God, for calling us your children. Help us to use our words, not to hurt, but to love. Amen. Thanks, guys. We'll see you again next time. And now let's hear our readings.
In our first reading, the prophet calls upon Israel to do justice in view of God's imminent intervention to save. Righteousness and obedience define who belongs to the Israelite community, not race, nationality, or any other category. A reading from Isaiah 56. Thus says the Lord, maintain justice and do what is right, for soon my salvation will come and my deliverance be revealed. And the foreigners who join themselves to the Lord, to minister to him, to love the name of the Lord, and to be his servants, all who keep the Sabbath and do not profane it, and hold fast my covenant, These I will bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar. For my house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples. Thus says the Lord God, who gathers the outcasts of Israel. I will gather others to them besides those already gathered. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our psalm today is Psalm 67. We begin with the refrain. May God be gracious to us and bless us, and make his face to shine upon us, that your way may be known upon earth, your saving power among all nations. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. Let the nations be glad and sing for joy, for you judge the peoples with equity and guide the nations upon earth. Let the peoples praise you, O God. Let all the peoples praise you. The earth has yielded its increase. God, our God, has blessed us. May God continue to bless us. Let all the ends of the earth revere him.
In our second reading, we hear God has not rejected Israel. Rather, the call and gifts of God are irrevocable, so that while all have been disobedient, God has mercy upon all. A reading from Romans 11. Paul writes then, has God rejected his people? By no means. I myself am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, a member of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not rejected his people whom he foreknew. For the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. Just as you were once disobedient to God, but have now received mercy because of their disobedience. So they have now been disobedient in order that by the mercy shown to you, they too may now receive mercy. For God has imprisoned all in disobedience so that he may be merciful to all. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let us sing our gospel verse. The Holy Gospel according to Matthew, the 15th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus left that place and went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Just then a Canaanite woman from that region came out and started shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." But he did not answer her at all. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she keeps shouting after us." But he answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." He answered, "It is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." And her daughter was healed instantly. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, your mercy is great. So come to us now, and through your word, work your mercy on our hearts and on our minds, that we may live out your mercy in all we say and all we do. Amen. So to begin with, let's get it right out there. This gospel today is got to be the most puzzling, shocking, maybe even offensive story in the whole Bible. Or at least certainly in the New Testament, right? I mean, it's one thing for these disciples to treat this desperate Canaanite mother with the contempt they do. I mean, knowing their fallibilities as we do, maybe we might expect this kind of bad behavior from them. But from Jesus? Really? Jesus doesn't just speak about her behind her back, notice. He outright ignores her, for starters. Then he blatantly excludes her with his statement that "I have come only for the lost sheep of the house of Israel." And finally, in the face of her last poignant and heartfelt plea, he outright insults her, calling her a dog, which, let's be clear, despite the historical distance between Jesus' time and ours, was no less derogatory back then as it is now. So yes, let's just say it out loud. Jesus' behavior here is abominable. Which is why there have been so many attempts over the years, of course, to explain it away. Explanations with varying levels of credibility and degrees of comfort. Maybe, some have suggested, maybe that word dog wasn't really an insult in Jesus' day. Maybe it was something more of a term of endearment, despite all the historical and cultural evidence being to the contrary. Or maybe Jesus was just testing his disciples, giving them a lesson here, teaching them something at this woman's expense, even though there's nothing in the text that even suggests that, and even though that would make this one awfully cruel lesson. Or maybe Jesus is actually learning something here about his mission. I mean, at least in Matthew's gospel, Jesus' ministry is mostly focused on bringing the good news to the Jewish people. So maybe this Canaanite woman is the occasion for Jesus to learn something, to learn that the good news isn't just limited to the Jews. And frankly, I got to admit, of all the explanations, that's the one that's probably most credible to me. And still the thought of Jesus having to learn the gospel, well, at the very least, that sits kind of awkwardly on our minds and our hearts, doesn't it? Lots of explanations. Still lots of questions. So maybe the thing to do with this story today is not to focus on explaining it, but instead to focus on what it does to us. Actually, I don't think that's a bad way to read our Bible in general. To not always try to dig underneath or try to explain everything we read, but sometimes just to ask, what does this text do to me? And when I ask myself that question, what this text does to me, I have to say, it inspires me. Yes, it confuses and offends me on a certain level, but it also inspires me. Inspires me mostly by the behavior of that woman. I mean, think about it. Given her low status as a woman back in that day, given the animosity between Jews and Gentiles that we know about, one would think that a cold shoulder would be enough to dissuade her from her quest, right? But not so. She ignores Jesus' rebuff here and his condescending retort and intensifies her plea. And when that's met with a racist taunt, she engages him. She engages Jesus almost as a rabbi debating with an equal, with a colleague on a point of theology, a remarkable position for her as a Gentile woman to assume. This woman is bold beyond any good sense. She's persistent, and she's fierce in her conviction that God is a God of mercy, and that God's mercy is for her too, and she refuses to let go. Despite everything here that would want to challenge and discourage her belief, she holds on, seeking without wavering the blessing that she's convinced is hers. Well, in the end, Jesus calls it faith. "Woman, great is your faith," he says. And it's in that detail that I find inspiration. In the way that this Canaanite woman gives us a picture of faith. You know, as Lutherans, we like to think of faith, talk of faith as trust, as a deep trust in God's love, God's presence, God's grace, and that indeed is what it is. That is what faith is. But that faith, that trust, is not a passive thing, not something that just waits around for God to show up someday, or is easily discouraged by the challenges we face. What this woman teaches us is that faith is active. Faith is persistent. Faith is tenacious. It's a trust that never stops expecting God's mercy to show up for us, even in our darkest times. It's a trust that never gives up praying, even when the silence in response is deafening. It's a trust that holds on tight to the promises of our baptism, even in our times of doubt and confusion. And it's a trust that never stops petitioning God or holding God to God's promises in all our need, no matter how deep that need may be. Just like this woman. And honestly, who among us hasn't had a time or a moment like this woman? Times when it feels like the cards of life have been stacked against us. Times when it feels like faith is the most ludicrous of ways to live. Times when it might even feel like even God is against us. Be that a pandemic that keeps getting worse, that keeps frustrating all our attempts to establish some level of normality. Be that the grief that haunts us long after a deep loss. Be that those prayers that never get answered. Be that the distress of a child's chronic illness. We've all had those times where our most trusted sources of help and comfort seem like they've turned their back on us. And it's then that the inspiring example of this Canaanite woman shines most brightly for us, showing us a faith that refuses to give up. A faith that remains fierce in the conviction that God is a God of mercy and that God's mercy is for us too. A faith willing to wrestle fearlessly with doubt and silence and rejection. And a faith that insists on believing that there is a blessing for us somewhere, even in our confusion. That's a faith that I aspire to, I know. It's a faith that I pray for. And it's a faith that this woman inspires in me and all of us, I think, today. And yet it's more than that, too. For this woman is not just persistent and bold on her own behalf. She's persistent on behalf of her sick child, the one who's truly in need of mercy in this story. This woman is convinced that not only is she loved, but that God's mercy is for all others, and that God's reign of mercy includes all, even the weakest, the smallest, the most vulnerable, the most victimized. And so she persists. She pushes. She advocates. She dares to step out of her rightful place and demand mercy for her child, even if that means disturbing the settled and prejudicial attitudes of the world around her, even if that means challenging the structures of inclusion that are so entrenched. She persists, trusting in a vision of God's mercy for all. And that is yet another inspiring picture of faith for us today. For these days we're living through, you know, they're not just days with the potential to magnify our own personal challenges. But as we've been discovering, there are days that have magnified the even deeper challenges of so many around us, right? The challenges faced by those who've been shut out from the blessings of food security, economic prosperity, employment opportunity, even personal safety by systemic racism and exclusionary attitudes. The challenges that racial minorities have faced in living out their hopes and dreams. The challenges that women have faced in seeking equality and respect. The challenges that our whole creation is facing in thriving and nurturing the life that its creator once blessed it with. These are days when we are becoming all too aware of the unmerciful ways of living that we have allowed to take root in our midst. But in this Canaanite woman, we have an example of faith that trusts deeply in the ways of God's kingdom. A faith that trusts deeply in the vision of a life governed by mercy, love, and compassion, and a faith that isn't afraid to work, even in the face of daunting challenges, to bring that vision just a little bit more into focus. That, too, is a faith I pray for. A faith I pray for all of us to have. A faith, yes, to tenaciously trust in God's mercy for us in our darkest times, but a faith also to trust in God's mercy for all. A faith to not shy away from the ugly realities we see in the lives of others around us. A faith to trust that all belong, all have a place in God's beloved community, all are worthy of blessing. And a faith unafraid to challenge what needs to be challenged, to disturb what needs to be disturbed, that those blessings might flow. Frankly, it's a faith echoed in our first reading today from Isaiah, right? Those words where God promises God's deliverance to the foreigners and the outcasts, and who calls the church to be a house of prayer for all peoples. It's a faith echoed in our psalm today, promising God's guidance for all the nations upon the earth. It's a faith echoed in Paul today, where he rejects the exclusion of the Jewish people from God's kingdom and boldly declares God's mercy for all. And it's a faith that's finally affirmed in the beautiful ending to this difficult gospel text, where God's mercy is finally poured out in healing, even for an outsider's child. Whatever the reason, whatever the explanation for Jesus' words here, this is a story to inspire our faith. A story to inspire faith through the actions of a Savior who reaches out beyond the boundaries and the limits to gather an outcast woman and her child into the embrace of God's care. And a story to inspire faith through the trust of a Canaanite woman who steadfastly clings to the vision of God's mercy for her and for all. So may her faith be our faith today and always. Amen. Let us sing now our hymn of the day, a hymn with contemporary lyrics to a familiar tune, a hymn called She Came to Jesus. Confident of God's care and helped by the Holy Spirit, we pray for the church, the world, and all those who are in need, singing. God, you call your church to be a house of prayer for all peoples. As Jesus acknowledged the faith of a woman from outside his people, open your church to the surprising blessings found in neighbors and others outside the church who we might easily overlook or ignore. Holy God, bless our congregation and all congregations of our BC Synod with wisdom, vision, and courage in these murky days of pandemic. Especially we pray today for Faith Lutheran Church in Kelowna and their pastor, Brian Crucial, for Gloria Day Lutheran Church in North Vancouver and their pastor, Vita Yagalis, and for Shepherd of the Valley Lutheran Church in Langley and their pastor, Kristen Steele. And Lord, be with the people of our companion synod, the Lutheran Church in Peru, as they mourn the death of Pastor Adita Torres, their president, who succumbed to the COVID virus this week. And Holy God, we pray for all parents, children, teachers, and administrators seeking a safe way to reopen schools this fall. Grant calm where anxieties are high, understanding where thoughts and perspectives differ, and wisdom where policies need to be created. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, send your spirit in this place. holy God, you desire that all the nations might be glad and sing for joy. Guide all the nations upon earth and those who lead them in the ways of justice and equity. We pray especially for the people of Belarus struggling under an authoritarian government, political turmoil, and a high level of COVID. Holy God, as you healed the daughter of the Canaanite woman, we pray for your healing, comfort, and mercy on all those in any need. We pray especially for Rick, Susan, Elaine, Alicia, Don, Jean, Sharma, Lori, Robert, Vivian, Carol, Carl, Pastor Jeff, and the family and friends of Pastor Edita Torres, and all those others we name before you now. And holy God, we pray for an end to the pandemic and for your mercy on all those affected in any way. Heal those infected. Protect those who've recovered from complications. Guide vaccine researchers. Bless doctors, nurses, and other frontline workers. Help all business owners. Comfort those who have lost employment and livelihoods. And ease the worry and anxiety affecting so many for all kinds of reasons. Lord, in your mercy. Holy God, you have blessed us with the bounty of the earth. And yet a report this week from the American Meteorological Society documents yet further the continuing devastation of climate change. Give us faith to trust that you are still somehow present with your creation, and inspire us by the example of the Canaanite woman to fearlessly challenge destructive ways of living and take up new and merciful ways of caring for our planet. Holy God, we pray for the people of Beirut and all of Lebanon. Be present with them in the midst of their misery. Move us all to respond to the call to help. Energize and guide those organizations seeking to respond on the ground. And make this a moment for the kind of change that country needs to rebuild itself in a way that allows all to flourish and thrive. And holy God, you have blessed us and continue to bless us daily. Hear our thanksgivings now for all the blessings of our lives which we name before you. Give us eyes to see your hand of blessing in our lives always, Lord, and lips to praise your goodness. Lord, in your mercy. In the certain hope that nothing can separate us from your love, we offer these prayers to you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Let us pray as our Savior taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial.
and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share the peace of Christ. And then let us enjoy some more pictures of hope. And then let us give thanks for the offerings we have received. God of mercy and grace, the eyes of all wait upon you, and you open your hand in blessing. Receive these blessings we return to you in thanksgiving, and inspire us to live in ways that reflect your generosity and justice. Through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer and Lord. Amen. Now receive the blessing. Neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. And God the Creator, Jesus the Christ, and the Holy Spirit the Comforter bless you and keep you in eternal love. Amen. We sing our sending hymn, number 859, Praise to the Lord the Almighty.
Thank you.
Go in peace, care for your neighbor, serve the Lord.